I didn't even have a passport at the time, so when I had to get a passport, get recognized in the airport, things like that, it was all so new. It was really amazing. Hi, this is Crystal Waters, and this is the story of Gypsy Woman. La da dee la da da. I grew up in South Jersey. People from Jersey know exit number 3. Small town, country farms. My father was a jazz musician. My uncle was Zach Zachary, who was the lead saxophonist, MFSB. Love is the message. I always used to watch him and my father listen to music, how they broke it down. I wrote poetry at a young age. It was something I saw my sister doing, and I had a couple classes, and I was very shy, very introverted, and I think the writing really helped me. So I used to sit in my room and write poetry. I went to school for computer science and started working in a computer room at the Parole Board in Washington, D.C. And I didn't start music until after I realized I wasn't going to make any money what I was doing. So then I started singing. My mom told me to go see a psychic. She was really into that stuff. So the lady told me that I wasn't doing something with my voice, and I wasn't going to be happy until I did it. So I was like, yeah, right, she's just guessing. And since I was so shy, I was like, I'm not going to be a public speaker. So I didn't know what she was talking about. I get back to work, and all my friends said, well, you love music, why don't you do something with music? One of my friends said, I have a cousin with a studio, and he's looking for background singers. He said, I'll go if you go. So I went, I got the job as a background singer. And when I got in the studio, it was kind of like a light bulb went off, like, this is where I should be. And I realized, you know, I'm gonna have to write my own songs. And I knew that I could write, because I was doing all the poetry. And I said, you know, that's what I'm gonna do. So I met a producer, and we started writing songs together. And we did a demo. And in Washington, D.C., there used to be a music conference. Me and my partner, I was in a group, Modern Art. We went down to the conference and snuck in. We found somebody opened a back door, and we snuck in. And I think the first people who caught my eyes were the Basin Boys. They had these leather jackets. And I was like, go give the demo to them. So I gave the demo to them that the conference let out, and I get home and the phone rings, and it's the Basement Boys. I mean, it had to be like 3 or 4 hours later, and it was Teddy. He said, I love what you do, we want to work with you. So I started writing Gypsy Woman. After I met the Basement Boys, they sent me a couple tracks to write to, and the first two tracks I wrote was Gypsy Woman and Making Happy. It was just something about that keyboard arrangement and Gypsy Woman that I just kind of latched. I had the la-da-dee-la-da-da right away. For the lyrics for Gypsy Woman, I came up, first I had this la-da-dee-la-da-da that I just kept, it was right around the bass line. And I was trying to put words to la-da-dee-la-da-da, and I was like, the syllables were too short. So I was like, okay, somebody's singing this song. And I was reminded of a woman who stood downtown in Washington, D.C., fully dressed in black, full face of makeup, and she was singing gospel songs and with a black hat out asking for money. I passed her like almost every week, and I was like, she looks fine. She needs to just go get a job. Why stop asking? I had an attitude. And then I read the story in a local paper that she had just lost her job, and she felt as if she was going to ask people for money, she should look respectable and be very respectable for asking people for money. And the whole story just changed my whole attitude about homelessness, because it was the late 80s and things were really bad in Washington. It was homelessness, it was AIDS was coming in, and it was just really a bad time. So I said, okay, it's this woman singing this song. So that's where it comes from. She wakes up early every morning just to do her hair because she cares. They wouldn't be right without her makeup. So it was really just about her and that story I read. She wakes up early every morning just to do her hair now because she cares, y'all. Her day I wouldn't be right without her makeup. I wrote it in my kitchen. I had rented a four track and I recorded it. And then I was in Washington, drove up to Baltimore for the Baseballs. I remember singing it for them, and Teddy just fell out the chair. And it was the first dance song I had ever written. Like I said, I was doing more of a Sade jazzy type thing. And I was just so happy that they were happy. So basically their studio was in the basement. That's why the Basement Boys. And the studio, the vocal booth was the bathroom. And they were in the next room over. I couldn't see them or anything. And they just stood me in there. And I just sang it a million times. I wrote La Da Dee La Da Da for like maybe 4 to 8 bars. But if you hear it in the original mix, it's like 32 bars. it's long, long. So yeah, it was a good time. When I wrote Gypsy, I was writing it for some of the artists on their label. Because like I said, I was doing more of a jazzy thing. So I thought, you know, that wasn't going to be my song. So when the Basement Boys told me that when they were shopping it, everybody loved my voice. And it was something about my voice that connected to it. I went from thinking I was going to be this R&B artist, and they shopped it around as me. And it got signed like right away to A&M Records in London. It sat from like 87 to 91 until Bruce Carbone from Mercury, which is sister label. I think Tony Humphries was playing it and he heard it in the club, and then he picked it up and that's where it went. Everybody kept saying, you have to go to the Sound Factory to hear this song and sit up on the speakers, because they had these big speakers. And I always remember seeing Madonna in there always sitting on these speakers, because you get to feel it. And in New York, when I got to New York, they took me to Sound Factory, sat me up on the speakers, and it was just amazing. And to see the club come alive when the song came on, and I could feel it through the speakers. You could just feel the whole energy of it, and it was just wonderful. It was the whole scene, Sound Factory, with the drag queens and the voguing and the battles, so it was really great to see.
On to the highest U.S. entry, number 3 now, from Crystal Waters, and a true song about a street singer in Washington. This is a song called Gypsy Woman.
First performed it on Top of the Pops. Gypsy had hit so hard they sent me straight to TV. It was the first time for the label to do any type of imaging with me, so it was a long day. I changed outfits like 3 or 4 times, and I ended up wearing what I wore on the airplane: jeans and a white T-shirt and some Doc Martens. The reaction to the song was major. It was amazing. I thought, you know, it would just be a big hit in the DC, Baltimore, New York area. So I know that's where it broke out in New York. So I was clueless to how it went around the world. As she stands there singing for money, la da dee la do da, la da dee la do da, la da dee la do da, la da dee la do da. I did feel like people only heard la da dee la da da and they didn't hear the message. I really poured my heart into that song. I really wanted to get that sentiment out into what I was, you know, singing. Tony Humphries told me the story that he actually went to the label because he was feeling the same way I was, that no one was hearing with the message. So on the second pressing of the vinyl, he argued with them and he got them to put a sticker on it. If anybody has this vinyl with this silver sticker on it, you should really keep it. And it says, she's homeless, la-da-dee, la-da-da. I remember getting a phone call from my A&R, I believe, Bruce Carbone. I didn't know what the dance chart was. I didn't. So when he was like, you have a hit, you have a kid, I was like, okay, you know. So it was really, you know, it was just so new to me. they did the video, you know, most labels want you half naked in the video, and that's not my personality. And they tried to put me in dresses and things like that, and finally they sat me down. They were like, okay, what are you like? Well, they showed me some pictures. And at the time, suits were big, and so they took me up to Armani. Armani gave me these suits, the black one and the white, and they just had the white background, and I just sat there and sang it, and I'm doing this move, which is basically crossing myself. I don't know why I started doing it, but it was a symbol to say thank you, kind of, for everything that was going on. I think one of the legacies for Gypsy is one of the first house songs to cross over to pop radio and open the world up to the whole community of house music.
Every morning, just to do her hair now, because she cares, y'all.
As time is going on, you know, I thought Gypsy Woman would have probably disappeared by now. But 30, 31, 32 years later, it's still played like it's brand new, and it still gets a reaction. I mean, I do shows now to people who are in their 20s. So it's a big deal to know that I did that. I feel like I did something good in my life.